Good afternoon and welcome to Leap of Faith webinar, Track and Trace, COVID-19 and Library Privacy. Thank you very much for joining us today. Please note that this webinar is recorded. Viewer microphones have been muted for this event, but we very much encourage you to stay engaged and let us know your thoughts, ideas, and questions in the Q&A and the chat box. Once again, many thanks for joining us today, and we look forward to hearing from all of you. This webinar will now start with an introduction by Ellen Tice, the chair of the Leap of Faith Committee and the president of the International Federation of Library Associations and Institutions from 2009 to 2011. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Valencia. Well, let me first start by greeting you all. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Unfortunately, I will not be able to do it in all the IFLA languages. we have people from all parts of the world. For some of us, it's in the morning, others in the afternoon, and others in the evening. It really gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this FAVE webinar titled Track and Trace, COVID-19 and Libraries Privacy. A warm and special welcome to our two speakers. I will just explain to you the procedure. They will be introduced by Jonathan Fernandez-Perez. I will give now immediately a short introduction. As I said, I will then hand over to Jonathan, who will introduce our two speakers. They will each respond to a couple of questions that Jonathan will put to them. And after the presentations, we will then have also a short panel discussion. In that session, we will ask them a few follow-up questions from each of the two speakers. And as Valencia had indicated, there will also be an opportunity for you, the participants, also to ask questions, and then we will have an open Q&A sessions. So then lastly, also, of course, a very, very warm welcome to all of you who have made yourself available this afternoon and that will basically participate in this very important and prudent webinar that we are hosting today. So as we all know, the COVID-19 pandemic is having a huge impact on life as we used to know it, on societies as a whole, and on the economies of all countries in the world. Again, over 33 million people already have fallen ill to date, over 1 million deaths, and billions of people have faced restrictions on their movements with serious economic consequences. In response to the COVID-19 pandemic, governments have introduced measures around biosurveillance, censorship, and misinformation that could have significant impacts on privacy rights. Among the initiatives, governments have passed laws relating to around the tracking of people's movements, communications and health data, leveraging telecommunications, camera footage, transport bookings, financial data, social media, facial recognition, and temperature checkpoints in restaurants and many other places, public places. In some cases, governments have deployed artificial intelligence to enable mass surveillance and social control, often without proper oversight, regulations, or checks and balances. And governments have been setting up these systems, but in many cases, private businesses are providing the tools. In this context, businesses may be aiding governments in measures that violate civil and political rights. Businesses may also be adversely impacting people's human rights without the involvement of governments. So the past months has revealed that it is not safe yet to lift all of these controls in place. And although we start talking about the new normal, we actually have not an idea what this will look like and when we will have this new normal. IFLA's own statements on library values, the public library manifesto, the position on intellectual freedom, on privacy in the library environment, on net neutrality, on fake news, IFLA guidelines on public internet access in libraries, and recently also adopted by the IFLA governing board, the statement on artificial intelligence and libraries, highlighting amongst others the right to a private life. These measures by governments referred to earlier raise serious privacy concerns for libraries. And this is what has led us to today's webinar. And as we have stated, many people, you know, as a result of what we have just referred to, are now working from home using commercial online tools and platforms. Schools and universities around the world employing distant learning solutions. Libraries have increased their remote services, and contact tracing and exposure notification technologies are being developed and launched. The data privacy implications of these issues are multiple and complex. And libraries who traditionally value our work to safeguard the privacy and confidentiality of our users as part of our commitment to intellectual freedom. As such, the pandemic has raised important questions that libraries around the world are working hard to address. So this afternoon, the webinar will focus on three main areas: library privacy protections in the new normal, finding the balance, and helping users protect themselves, as you have seen in our communication with you. So the two speakers will address, as I indicated to you, a couple of questions, and they will focus on these three areas that I have identified. And that's where I will leave it for now and hand over now to Jonathan, who will take over the next session.
Thank you very much, Ellen. Hello and welcome to today's FAFE webinars, as Ellen mentioned, on track and trace, COVID-19 and library privacy. Thank you for taking time out and being here today. I'm Jonathan Hernandez from the Library and Information Research Institute at UNAM Mexico and an IFLA governing board member. So, as Ellen mentioned, we will start the first part of this webinar with the speaker's presentation. And in the second part, we will have a panel discussion focused on ensuring privacy and confidentiality in libraries today. So, I'd like to introduce today's speakers. I'm pleased to introduce Yasuyo Inoue. She is a professor at Tokyo University, Saitama, Japan, working on public librarianship and school librarianship courses. She has been a member of the Intellectual Freedom Committee of Japan Library Association and a former member of IFLA FAFE Committee. Now, she's an IFLA FAFE expert advisor. Thank you very much, Yasuyo, for being here. I'm glad to present also Lisa Janicki Hinchliffe. She is a professor and coordinator for Information Literacy Services and Instruction, University Library at the University of Illinois. She is co-secretary general of the UNESCO GAPMIL International Steering Committee. Lisa, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you.
So I would like to address a couple of questions to start the presentation. So I would like to share my screen. So those are a couple of questions. For example, what skills and resources do librarians need in order to continue protecting user privacy in new circumstances? And what tools do you think could help information professionals in this? And a second dimension, can you think of a few simple and practical measures any library can take to begin addressing the new and evolving privacy challenges? How can libraries approach emerging, evolving privacy issues, specifically in relation to the more vulnerable groups among their communities? And if are there any significant differences in how various types of libraries are experiencing and tackling the new user privacy challenges? And finally, well, we know that traditionally, many libraries have worked to help their communities develop digital skills to access and use online information more confidently and safely. Does the pandemic require libraries to significantly adapt these efforts? And what advice would you give to libraries that want to start offering online privacy learning opportunities. So, Yasuyo, would you like to take the floor on this?
Hello, can you hear me?
It's okay now. Yes, it's okay now. Thank you.
Thank you. So today I'd like to present mainly 3 points relating to privacy issues at libraries in Japan. I hope you can take some examples when you reopen or open your library in your own countries. As you know, Japan is one of the countries where not so many infectious COVID patients like US or India or Brazil. But still, there are more than 500 persons per day now. So libraries need to protect those people, the public, from COVID. At libraries in Japan, not like US or other countries, not so many ebooks are offered to use, maybe less than 1,000 titles. It is because of the copyright issues or publishers' business policy. They are publishing ebooks, but they don't like to offer to the libraries. So that's the problem. That's why the opening library facilities is really essential issues for the public, especially for young children, elementary school kids or junior high school kids. They really need opening the library facility. In April, Japanese government seems not to have taken strict lockdown policy. But after that, more and more, the government realized that situation is really bad. So government sent an official notice to local government office, and it asked the schools, public facilities, including the museums, archives, and libraries are all shut down. Libraries or librarians were annoyed and asked the Japan Library Association what to do and how to do in. So in May 14th, JLA publicized guidelines to prevent expanding infection of COVID-19 at libraries. The guideline mentioned how to keep the facilities and library materials clean and how to protect the public. But it also says to take visitors' records and make them to write down about the visitors' names, addresses, the purpose of the visit, and the titles to be used with date and time. So librarians, especially public librarians, really strongly hesitate to follow that keeping library visitors' record. It is against Article 3 of the Statement on Intellectual Freedom of Libraries in Japan. What is Article 3 of the Statement of Intellectual Freedom at Libraries in Japan? The statement itself declared in 1954, revised in 1979. At that time, 1979, the Article 3 was added. Libraries guarantee the privacy of users. That means libraries include all library staffs and volunteers keep users' privacy. That is what users read or circulate or visit in library record. So same as Article 3 of the Code of the Ethics, Japanese Code of Ethics, which was declared in 1980s. Since JLA declared this statement along with this Code of Ethics, librarians have been publicized, explained, discussed, educated and trained the community people and mass media people, and especially library staffs who are not professional librarians. So that is why Intellectual Freedom Committee already publicized on the web, we do not recommend collecting visitor record on May 10th, but the guideline against the statement and the code of ethics, librarians activity group, like Toshokan Mondai Kenkyukai, doubted and demanded the JLA to revise the guideline. Same as publishers group also doubted and against that guideline. So even library users who understand the library's principles, libraries guarantee the privacy of users, doubted this guideline, and some of them just went home without getting into the library buildings. So in May 26, JRA revised the guideline. And before that, JRA publicized the explaining information, how JRA discussed with whom and why JRA made up this guideline in May 20th on JRA web. Also, Intellectual Freedom Committee, Japan Library Association Intellectual Freedom Committee, has been corrected practical information and cases when librarians opened the public during COVID-19 pandemic and publicized on the Intellectual Freedom Committee web. There are basic information like prevent 3Cs, but also how to promote the library policy on the library users' privacy. 3Cs, I think you know well that prevent crowded spaces, prevent crowded places, and prevent close contact settings. Not all libraries, including public, academic, and school libraries, hired professional trained librarians who are educated at graduate school level in Japan. So very few. So on-the-job training is very important issue. So Intellectual Freedom Committee collected and show the practical information and the cases to the library staffs who don't know how to do that. So what we need to do now in the future, I think one is transparency is very important. We give the information to the public, community people, and mass media people, how librarians or library staffs think and act to protect library users' records for making ready for each person's to read anything at all. So libraries protect the users what they read on what kind of knowledge they get or whatever communicate with whoever they meet at the libraries. They can free to read, they can do anything at libraries without worrying. Then confidentiality is also important because that transparency and show what we do makes the people feel confident toward the library activities. So even non-trained library staff or non-trained library staffed library can follow the practical cases and the informations, then they can follow and maybe they can arrange on their own situation. And then the public, the community people feel confidentiality on library and library staffs to protect the library users' privacy. So if there are a lot of already trained professional librarians at each libraries, maybe they can discuss and try to do whatever they should do. But in Japan, not all libraries hired professionals, so very practical on-the-job training style is effective, both libraries and the public. So this is very short presentation for me. So I will accept questions or opinions from the audiences. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yasuyo, for this interesting perspective from Japan. I'm glad to see all these efforts from the Japan Library Associations coming up, and I think that this is an important work. So now let's move to Lisa. Hello, Lisa. Can you please give us your perspective on this?
Yes, absolutely. And my thanks to Yasuo and her wonderful presentation. I think there are many similarities with the general state of things as far as a variety of different shutdowns and libraries changing their service profiles. Of course, my experience and expertise is with academic libraries. So that is primarily where my thinking has been. I was very fortunate, I think, to take on a role voluntarily in the United States with a colleague, Christine Wolf Eisenberg at Ithaca SNR, where we helped academic libraries last March and April who were in the process of transitioning their services to benchmark and gather information with a sort of real-time survey that we created where those results were shared. Our focus there was, of course, not on how privacy policies were evolving, but literally, are you keeping your building open? Are your staff working remotely? Some very big picture issues. But I think what we have seen since, if you will, having pivoted very suddenly, if you will, in the moment, is that this time of this pandemic has revealed many things to us on so many different topics. But one of the things I think it has revealed for us is that our library policies and practices may not be as fully informed about the current milieu of the way information architectures work, particularly with respect to information that is delivered online, or even more so via an app. And so we have very robust privacy policies and training and education around topics like physical book checkout and circulation records. We have policies around, say, security cameras in our libraries, policies around when people ask us a question, that we don't reveal what they are asking us about. I think that as so much of our users' work has shifted online, virtual, remote, which of course was even true before, I like to say sometimes that every learner was always a remote learner from the library, and sometimes they came in. The primary mode our users have been accessing us, seeing library resources, has been digital for a significant period of time, especially in academia and research libraries. Now that it is predominantly that, in some cases only that, we're seeing that our policy and practices regimes have not kept up with the kind of technological infrastructures that we're currently relying on. And in fact, many times the ways that user data is collected, harvested, shared, even sold, is not immediately apparent to us. And then when we do become aware of it, we become quite overwhelmed with what to do about it. It seems very daunting. And so that's where my personal work related to privacy practices has really focused, which is on building the capacity of academic libraries to engage with these issues so that we can at least be at the table for these conversations as our users' environments are changing. So there's a number of layers to understanding privacy in this era of fully networked access to information, and particularly with respect to apps on people's mobile devices. There is a technical layer to understanding how this infrastructure and these services work that is sometimes beyond many individual librarians' personal expertise. Even as I try to read all the information that different apps represent themselves to me, I do not always understand how the settings on my mobile device interact with the settings on a particular app. Or when I use two apps at the same time, or even more so, if I'm logged into my Gmail account, it actually is impacting what's happening over here and vice versa. These things are quite networked and interrelated in ways that is very difficult to track. And more to the point, if you start shutting off of these features, many of the value that we would get out of these applications and apps starts to disappear. And so we are faced with sort of a resigned acceptance to a certain kind of unwanted intrusion into our information seeking activities, because our information seeking cannot go forth without those intrusions. And so this is a real challenge for us that we have to grapple with and think about where in the system would we be able to advocate. So a big question for me, and a project I worked on with the NISO, National Information Standards Organization in the US, was the privacy principles for third-party providers, a set of voluntary principles that articulated the ways that libraries and service providers and database providers, publishers, et cetera, all generally said, we believe this is the way users should be treated within our information environments. One of the principles, for example, is that people should have to opt in to kinds of sharings rather than have to opt out. It's a matter of defaults. Number of other principles, but as I mentioned, I hope everyone caught those. Those are voluntary principles. And so it's great to have them articulated, but no one is obligated to them. And so we still have to ask our service providers what they are doing in order to meet those voluntary principles and ask them to be meeting those voluntary principles. And of course, we have to do this in our libraries ourselves, because there are many libraries that run our own databases. We have publishing arms coming out of our libraries. And sometimes libraries, in those cases, when they themselves are the platform providers, are not compliant with these principles either. So how are we going to address this very challenging situation? Clearly, we have to build our capacity. We have to build our capacity at the technology level, but also at the policy level. How do we develop policies that at least articulate the way we expect these things to work? And then how do we also develop our capacity to advocate for those policies and implementation? One of the biggest things we need, of course, is our own response to these situations to be robust. In particular, we need also the ability to speak, especially at our campus settings, because our campuses will move on with implementing many of these technologies, whether the library is at the table for the discussions or not. And so we also may literally need to be getting ourselves into the room where these conversations are taking place, because libraries are dependent on technology infrastructures that other people implement. Those people on campus may or may not share our library values and understanding of what privacy means. So as I mentioned when I began this, COVID has really revealed to us that maybe our organizations were not as resilient as we thought they were. Many libraries are struggling in many ways to respond themselves to the pandemic, but certainly as well to respond to the new challenges that are being placed upon us. As was already mentioned, some libraries are being asked to take people's temperature when they enter a space. Is that information recorded? If it is recorded, how is it secured? If it is recorded and secured, is it ever destroyed? Is it shared with anyone? These are the kinds of questions we've asked ourselves historically about book circulation records. And so we have to just get in a routine and a habit where we ask this time and time again about any user data that is created. Now, we probably can't function in a network society without people's data being captured in some way. One of the most simple ways I can say is we all want the back button to work on the web browser. In order for the back button to work, it has to record where you just were in order to send you back to it. But how long does it keep that? And who has access to that? Are questions we need to ask. So roles for libraries and therefore roles for our capacity building. First, that we make sure that our own practices are in good order. What are we doing in the areas that we ourselves control? Are our practices a model for what it means to be a prioritizing privacy organization on our campuses or in our communities? Second, we have to articulate our principles and advocate with governments and other and third-party providers to implement those same practices and principles that we have chosen when it is in our control. When it's someone else's control, we need to ask them to live up to those same standards. And with that advocacy comes the willingness to use the leverage that we do have, which is advocacy, transparency, outreach, but it is also the power of our spending. We are the customer for many of these platforms, and so we should be entering into these conversations about privacy at the time where we are contracting for these services. Finally, we need to develop outreach and education programs for our end users. If we as information professionals are challenged by, stymied by, confused by the kinds of settings, policy statements, all these various issues, it only stands to reason that our end users are at least equally confused as we are. And we are trusted parties. We know this from study after study after study that says that people trust their libraries to assist them, to support them, to educate them. So it is our opportunity to also create a privacy literate population, whether it is at our campus or within our community, so that individuals also feel that they have the necessary knowledge in order to question, in order to make informed choices, and in order to advocate for the kind of privacy world in which they would like to live, as opposed to being resigned to one in which their data is regularly harvested from them against their will because there is no other option. So libraries have, with our professional skills, our training, our commitments, our values, and of course our wonderful associations like IFLA, the opportunity to lead the conversation on our campuses and our communities, while recognizing that times like the pandemic will require extraordinary measures, because privacy when you are quite sick or perhaps even passed away is not as valuable as if you are living. And so the other thing I think ultimately we have to think about for the time of the pandemic, what practices will we accept during a time of great danger and need, but that we need to ensure are not normalized so that they continue after they are no longer needed for this reason. And so that's the final thing I'll kind of put on the table for us to think about which is what does it mean to keep something and to make sure that something is held as an extraordinary practice for extraordinary times. But when those times pass, those extraordinary practices are not normalized, but rather are removed as no longer relevant, so that we don't have an erosion of what is the baseline that people should expect for their privacy while we have a time of exception. So I look forward to this wonderful discussion I suspect is to come, as well as our questions and answers from our attendees here today.
Thank you, Lisa, for this great input and for telling us about the privacy principle for third-party providers. I think that this is so interesting. And well, before we move to the panel, we want to give you, to all the attendees, an opportunity to start preparing questions, and please send them to the chat as we move to the panel discussion. Thank you very much, Yasuyo and Lisa. So I'll give the floor to Ellen.
Thank you, Jonathan, and thank you for those comments and contributions. So to start off the panel discussion, which we will, I think we can make it more interactive by, you know, I'll ask one question and then we can then take one or two questions as well. So I'm going to start with you, Yasuyo. And if you have addressed this in the presentation, then you don't have to answer it. We can go to the second one. But so the first question is, could you tell us a bit about the process of adapting and reopening library services in Japan? What were the key privacy considerations, the tensions and challenges? How were they addressed? And what is the situation like now?
Thank you, Evan. I think I need to define the definition of the privacy is maybe different among the each countries, I think. I think my country, privacy is really key issue, not only for librarians, but also for the public. Right now, it's very difficult. How can I explain that? Not only libraries, but also each local government or government, we set up the ordinance, it called the Protect of Private Informations. So even if the platforms, the business people gather the big data through the library app, they cannot use without permission from the local government. Otherwise, they have to pay a lot of money or something like that. So I think maybe the situation is different. So now the libraries, when we ask business companies to do some management of the library activities, including AI or other digital systems, they must show what they use the big data collecting the personal private records. So maybe that is one of the reasons why they don't want to provide the digital books to libraries.
Okay. Thank you very much. The next question I'll ask Lisa. Could you tell us a bit about the prioritizing privacy project and your other work focusing on privacy in the library context? So the focus of prioritizing privacy, I understand, is of course in academic libraries and learning analytics, but could this project perhaps offer any lessons or insights for library privacy practices at large, especially in the current circumstances? And did the COVID-19 pandemic impact you and your colleagues thinking on the subject?
So thank you so much for asking about that. I'm very proud of this work that we're doing right now. This is an IMLS funded project, and that's the Institute of Museum and Library Services, which is the federal agency in the United States that funds libraries and museums and grant making in this area. So the Prioritizing Privacy Project is a capacity developing project for academic librarians to bring privacy questions and considerations to campus learning analytics projects. So since not everyone works in academic libraries or may not have this kind of initiative, learning analytics is an area of activity in our institutions where data is captured about students in the process of doing their studies. Often data that is not just academic related, but also things like, do they use the recreational center? How often do they go to the library? a variety of different aspects in order to create profiles of students. The goal in doing this at our institutions is to be able to identify students who perhaps are struggling in order to give them additional resources, to identify students maybe who are not struggling but are not taking full opportunity of the resources that are available to them in an institution. So the goals of learning analytics are very worthy, but as you already just heard, all this data that's being collected. So there's questions about whether students realize such data is being collected, whether they have consented to that data being collected, but even more so, have they been fully informed that this data will be brought together in order to essentially create a new data set where these things, so students may be fine with the library knowing how often they come to the library and the rec center knowing how often they go to the recreational center, but they may not want that data combined together. So the degree to which students understand what is happening, have choice in what is happening, are fully informed, free to opt out, all these sorts of things are major privacy questions within learning analytics. Library data is very, very attractive for people who work in learning analytics because it not only is physical data, although in COVID it's less of whether you've come to the library, but of course it's how often did you use the library databases? Did you check out any books? Have you ever talked to a librarian? Have you had a library instruction or information literacy session? The library generates data. There's data that is generated every time a student interacts with a service. So that data is very attractive, but libraries themselves have often told people that we don't track you, that it's a very private place. So this is why we have to get our policies and our practices, et cetera, aligned. My co-PI on this project is Kyle Jones, who's at Indiana University, University of Indiana at Purdue. And he is also running another project that I'd like to just mention where he is the PI with another team called Data Doubles, in which they are doing research with students about how they understand the data collection that is happening at their campuses and how they feel and perceive how that data is being used. So that look is at students. Kyle and I are looking then at librarians' capacity to join those conversations on campus. Do they feel confident speaking in that environment? Do they have the skills and knowledge to speak in that environment? And do they have strategies for advocacy for data protections and security on behalf of students, as well as ensuring that the things we've told people about their library use stays true, that you know it is not revealed. So this is definitely a capacity building project. I have two other smaller grants as well related to this privacy area, one of which I think is very relevant with what IFLA's statement on artificial intelligence now, which is a research group on our campus of people who, from the perspective of privacy and ethics, are looking at how artificial intelligence is interacting with societal expectations and the like, particularly related to privacy, security, and this time of disinformation. So there is no end to the amount of work to be done in this area. So.
Okay, great. And I think the enthusiasm and so on. So thank you very much. So I have one more question for each of you so that we can give our participants also an opportunity for you to answer their questions. So I think Yasu, you already, explained in your presentation about the, you know, how the libraries, Japanese libraries have evolved since the statement, the original association statement on intellectual freedom, etc., and how the pandemic had impacted their views on that. So I just going to ask you, you know, maybe if you could give a short answer to this one. What role do you see libraries in Japan playing in relation to privacy and confidentiality now in society at large, looking into the future in the coming years?
Well, that is a very big question because Japan is maybe very technically digital, high level country, but library is a kind of old fashioned place. So we have to think about that, how to connect to that high tech and the old fashioned library way of thinking. So how can we, react or reflect the old principles to the new high tech system in the society? Like 98% of the high school kids, they have the smartphones, so they don't like the a classification system in the library. But how can we attract them? How can we teach them what is privacy for you, something like that? So I think Japanese librarians still try to keep going on the same principles and a new way to expand the confidentiality among the community people. I believe so.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. And Lisa, just my last question to you. I think you have addressed, already given us some ideas and good practices that libraries can draw on or replicate. And I think for me, what stood out from your contribution was actually libraries just looking at our own practices and that we actually practice what we preach. That in itself can already, because if we do that, and then you also mentioned that we have to be at the table at the institutions or where the decisions are made or what measures are going to be implemented. So I think you have already given us some ideas. So my last question to you is just, how does your work within UNESCO's GAMPL impact your views on privacy? That's GAMPIL. I'm sure you will tell us more about that. What do you think is the role of MIL in privacy and personal data protection? And what do you think libraries can partner or cooperate with to champion privacy in their communities?
Yeah, so thank you very much. The UNESCO GAPMIL project, Global Alliance for Partnerships in Media and Information Literacy, just rolls right off the tongue. So that's why we call it GAPMIL. It's this media and information literacy is the phrasing that UNESCO has adopted. And of course, IFLA works closely with UNESCO in this area. So when I was chair of the IFLA information literacy section, we were of course working very closely with the UNESCO staff there. But now in my role as co-secretary general, and some other very well-known IFLA names on the library side are also involved, with Jesus Lau being currently one of the co-chairs of the International Steering Committee. So it's great to work with him again there as well. So, you know, media and information literacy, I think, is a framework for us to in which to embed our privacy literacy training, particularly for our students. And in that media and information literacy, we have not only librarians, we have technologists, we have a number of journalists who are engaged with that UNESCO project, people who are in the information industry, if you will, in different parts of it. So one of the great things about that project is that it really lets us see the common cause we have, as well as the opportunity to bring our unique skills and strengths from our respective professions to addressing common issues of concern. One thing about media and information literacy is it's related to almost everything these days, because what isn't related to media and information literacy? And so we particularly often are also concerned in those settings with issues of equity and inclusion, and who is left out of the media and information literacy landscape. One thing we haven't even had a chance, because there's just so many topics here, is to talk about how violations of user privacy often unequally impact those who are already marginalized or otherwise disenfranchised within our societies or within our organizations. So I could give specific examples from the US, but we can think about them from all of our respective countries of who those folks might be and how some of these extractive practices are even more dangerous and even greater violation of their human dignity than we might be experiencing if we are in the majority cultures. So there's a lot of different ways, I think, that media and information literacy gives us a lens to think about privacy, but then our programs of media information literacy are a platform for that privacy literacy education that I was speaking about earlier.
Thank you very much. I again hand over to Jonathan now, who will, in Valencia, who will direct the other questions from the participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ellen, Lisa, and Yasuyo. So if the audience have more questions, please send them through the chat. Now, we have a comment saying that interactions between apps and phones can be frustrating, like warnings that pop up when you try to switch off the app, which can feel like it's forcing consent. So What do you think about this? I mean, I have on mind the Social Dilemma documental on Netflix on this question. So what do you think about this? If anyone can answer or give a comment.
So I think this was perhaps playing off some of my comments around the app environment, which I think libraries have not fully engaged. We've done better with thinking about web-based services, but I think the biggest point I would sort of say with that is I think it just continues to reinforce for us our sense of lack of agency. We have all these screens, they don't always state things in as clear language as they could. We have, you know, I'm thinking, Jonathan, when you just said, you know, the Social Dilemma, right? Which is a really great documentary, but, you know, when you look at it, it's such a US-based and US-focused look at what is really a global question. Yeah. And so that's, I think, another thing that I think a lot about, which is, you know, I'm very fortunate in many ways, privileged that my native language is English. My only language is English, which is a real limitation. But, you know, what it would be like if I was having to negotiate all of these very complex things and then not in a language that I'm as fluent or comfortable in. And so it just, I think it makes sense why people end up just sort of disparaging and say, fine, like I can't. Yeah. And that is, you know, anytime we get in that place where we think we can't make a difference or we can't, we have no agency, it's a very, it's not a good feeling, I guess is the way I would say it. And, you know, so how can we skill ourselves in a way that gives us some agency? But also, in some cases, the fact is we don't have agency, right? Technology providers are currently allowed to do things that, you know, don't give us choices. And so then we have to move into that advocacy mode I was talking about, where we say, no, we want choices. And here's the kinds of choices that we want. And, you know, we've seen some great, you know, GDPR is often upheld as a great, you know, but for me, GDPR is the beginning, not the end of this discussion. In the United States, we see some states taking action, not the federal government as much. But we've also seen countries in the rest of the world, especially a couple of South American and African countries who have taken a real leadership role in this area of trying to regulate. But of course, that gets very pulled into the issues of economic superpowerness. And so it's just lots and lots of things. that come into play. But, you know, even GDPR is an interesting thing, because when I've been traveling in Europe, because not all US news organizations choose to become compliant with GDPR, I will then be reading my regular news sources and I will hit one that I can't read because I'm in Europe, mm-hmm. even though I'm an American and it's an American news source. And so that is also a question of freedom of access to information, right? Where a regulation, which was well-intentioned, has this unintended consequence of actually resulting in blocked information because of a decision that the third party makes about just not bothering to comply. So very, very complex issues, I think, here.
Thank you, Lisa. I agree with you that this is a very complex issue. And I think that with the social dilemma, certainly, I think that even that it's a good way to start the debate, it's just a small part of the whole problem. So it is important to address this. And thank you very much, Lisa. Yasuyo, we have a question. And on what do you, how do you think library privacy will evolve in Japan?
Let me see. I think mainly most of the libraries are public libraries. So Japan Library Association listened to the public libraries' opinions, because the professional librarians legally are hired at the public libraries. So the problem is academic research libraries, because there's no obligation to hire the professional librarians. So we need to educate or train the library staffs at the academic or university libraries. They don't know about the library issues a lot. So the Japanese Library Association, I don't know what they are thinking about that situation, because the university librarians, they have their own associations, and the, maybe we have to think about more, because new prime minister wanted to set up the what they call the digital agency. So the cabinet want to decrease the price of the telephone price, so more people want to use the libraries through the digital format, same as in the US right now. So maybe from next year, the issues, not only the private things, not only old style, but also the digital lines, what we should do, we have to think about that. Is that answer for you?
Yes, sure. Thank you, Yasuyo. So we are, thank you, Yasuyo. I think that we're running out of time. So I would like to thank you again, and I would like to point out some key points during these discussions. So we all agree that library privacy has been a core value in our profession. And there is an important thing that I like to mention, that we need to build our capacities. Lisa mentioned this, but at different levels. I mean, at a technological level and a policy level. And of course, an ability to speak about privacy issues. And another point is that, of course, libraries are increasing their remote services, and the data privacy implications are expanding their complexity. And we need to reinforce the transparency. This was saying by Yasuyo, which means give the information to the public. And because it is important to say how librarians are acting to protect library users. We must remember that libraries are trustful institutions. And of course, there is the importance of media and information literacy, and the need to engage with people who are in the information industry, not only with librarians. I think that we need to talk, we need to do some work with people related with the information industry. So that will be some key points during this discussion. So Ellen, would you like to take the floor and close this session? Ellen?
muted. Yes, I started to talk. Yeah. I also put my video on. I was just saying that thank you very much. This was really a very enriching session this afternoon, and to learn, you know, from Lisa and Yasu, you know, from their various projects and some of the experience that they have. And I definitely think, even though, you know, Japan, you know, in terms of its high tech, and then, you know, and in the US, I think, as Lisa also said, you know, many of the things that are happening in there, you know, apply very much in other parts of the world, maybe not to the same extent, but more or less. So I just want to end with the statement by the ALA's Intellectual Freedom Committee on June 8, 2020, where they said, and just bringing together what others have already said this afternoon, the right to privacy is one of the foundations upon which our libraries are built. Privacy is one of the key reasons libraries are such a trusted part of every community. In a world that thrives on surveillance and data mining, libraries provide a safe place for users of all ages to seek out information free from unreasonable intrusion into or surveillance of their use. As libraries across the world have shut their doors due to the COVID-19 pandemic, we face the challenge of upholding our commitment to not monitor, track, or profile an individual's library's use beyond our operational needs. Confronted with this global health emergency, and as we see in many parts of the world, civil unrest as well as a result of this, now more than ever, we must ensure that our libraries continue to provide uninterrupted, safe, and confidential access to our services in accordance with our core values and the laws that protect the confidentiality of library users' information. And I think something that Soya said was also that it's really about mixing and those traditional values of us now with these high-tech practices that are taking place. How can we bring that together, and how can we balance this and educating our users? So thank you again very, very much. As Lisa said also, there's so much happening, so much to do. And I'm sure, you know, with IFLA and what IFLA, the role that IFLA plays in this is to ensure that we keep doing that, that we should not give up. It depends also, our future depends on it in terms of what libraries can do. So once again, thank you very much to all. Thank you to Valencia for all the organization, you know, behind the scenes and ensuring that we were able to present this webinar this afternoon. Much appreciated.
Thank you for the opportunity to participate.
Thank you. And happy 93 years of IFLA.
Thank you. Bye.